Well, praise God, everybody. Great to be in the house of God. I know that you're alive and well and ready to make a difference in this world. Amen. We are launching a new series this morning, and I need to make some disclaimers because of the very title of this series. Some of you may already be offended, but we live in a culture where people are offended at everything. And their anger can explode at you on Facebook if you just offer an opinion. And so I think it's critical in the day that we're living to understand that when bitterness or unforgiveness is harbored in our heart, it restricts our ability to walk by faith. And faith is the avenue through which miracles happen. Faith is the substance of things and the evidence. Do y'all read your Bible? Okay, just checking with your class. I majored in education for a couple of years, and that's the reason I got out of it. Because I did an extension class in Highland, Illinois, in the distributive education program. And back in 1974, they would get up and walk out of the classroom. And I went, I'm not handling this really well. And then there are people that are offended at your offense. And so we're trying to navigate this. And the Bible says in Matthew 18 that if somebody offends you, you need to go to them. But when you go to them, you're not quite sure how the response is going to be. And I've had some people that were offended at the issue that I brought up. And so we have found ourselves in the church, in our culture, that has been very overwhelming, and it has restricted our ability to relate to one another. And if there's anywhere we should be able to sit down and have a conversation and communicate and say, listen, you may not have meant this, but this is what happened. And sometimes we get this: I don't remember that, I didn't say that, or you're not remembering it correctly. So then you just go, well, it doesn't do me any good to try to deal with these issues. And I think, if you will excuse my terminology just for a moment, I think that not dealing with this whole subject has caused the church to be constipated. I apologize before I said that. So it is required by you to forgive me. Well, that didn't go over very well. But We live in this culture where politics are a hot issue. The gay agenda, transgender, is a hot agenda. Some of you may not be aware of the most recent theological discussion that's happening, and it's called not redirection, but reconfiguration. And it works this way. Jesus had the Spirit of Christ. But so did Muhammad, and so did Buddha. So that's the philosophy that is running rampant in our culture. And it's running rampant because people do not have a knowledge of the Word of God. The foundation of the Word of the Lord is not in their life. And so truth is simply truth according to them. And how can you say that what I believe is not truth? Because if you go to the Bible, they will say there's no absolute truth anymore. And it's a lack of fundamental, foundational teaching in the kingdom. But the Lord spoke to me and said, just bide your time, hold your peace, because the day will come when they will need a miracle in their life, and because they have no foundational, fundamental truth, they don't know who to call on. And whoever they call on, whether it's a doorknob or a tree is their higher power, or their car or their dog was really Aunt Sally, and she's come back to work out all of her imperfections in her life. That's Hinduism, reincarnation. They're going to come to a point where things are going to be so conflicted and chaotic. They're going to need God to move in their life, but they will be aware of those people around them that are godly, that live in Christ Jesus, that walk in the power of the Spirit, that walk in the anointing of God. So don't be surprised if all of the sudden those that have rejected you are needing you to pray for them because they need a miracle and their higher power is not answering the call. The problem is this. If you have offended them and not loved them, the Bible says a brother offended is harder to win than a city. And so we have this conglomeration of ideology that is floating around on the internet and in our lives. And I may in the next few weeks offend some of you inadvertently, but I will do that to help you get over what you get offended by. I wouldn't leave service yet. It would look pretty conspicuous. And so if we're going to walk in faith, if we're going to walk in the power of God, if we're going to take the elements out of our life so that we can be the vessel that I know that you have prayed and asked God to create you to become, then we have to deal with the whole issue of offenses. And it is a multi-structured element, and you cannot just cover it in one service. So let me take you to James chapter 1 and verse 19. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters, you must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Now that does not describe our culture today because we are the exact opposite. We are quick to be angry. We are quick to speak. We are quick to let people know what we think. We have lost the art of listening because we want to make a point and not make a difference. And so it's critical that we learn to do that. If you've ever followed and ever been on Facebook, it's interesting to watch what happens because there are people on Facebook that present a particular absolute opinion, and if you don't respond and they know that you're a born-again believer, they're pressing your buttons going, why are you not responding truth, truth, truth to this? Why are you not responding to something? Because some things are not worth responding to. It is amazing because we sometimes get offended. Have you ever text anyone and you know they're online because you see the bubbles and you're waiting for an answer and you get no response? In fact, they ghost you. And now I'm really ticked because I know you were on there and now you're not responding. So we go wild in our consideration and we go, well, what did we do to offend them? They're always upset. They've always got an attitude and they're in find the challenges of much of our relational issues. Have you ever wondered how many questions Jesus was asked? Jesus was asked 183 questions. He only responded to three because he was slow to speak and quick to hear, and he was slow to anger. He did, however, ask 308 questions, some of them in response to the questions that he was asked. And in the midst of that, it's amazing to watch how Jesus responded. Would it be fair to say that Jesus Christ was the most incredibly anointed communicator and navigator of relationships on the planet? You may hate him, you may like him, but you can't ignore him, because he made a difference in people's lives. If I was Jesus and the disciples came to me and James and John's mom came to me and said, listen, Jesus, can I talk to you for just a minute? We've been having a conversation over wings and potato salad at our house, and I would like to know, would it be possible to put one of my sons on one side of the throne and one on the other side when you come into your kingdom? If I was Jesus, I would have lost it. I would have excommunicated James and John from the church before the church ever got established. Because the disciples were quick to respond. They were quick to get angry. They were quick to be overwhelmed. And sometimes, you see groups of people on Facebook. We believe in life groups in New Life. On Facebook, I think there's anger groups that are looking for something they can hate about. And so when they find it, them and their 12 friends get together and they want everybody to like what they've hated. And if you don't like what they've hated, they're mad at you because you didn't respond at what they don't like. And some of them go, it's just righteous anger. Let me ask you something. Isn't it amazing that people get offended and they respond in what they call righteous anger? But have you ever noticed that their righteous anger is always directed at someone else? My question is, when does the righteous anger, when is it focused on your sin? And we go, can you believe the sexual idolatry that person is displaying? But we forget about the hidden lust that we hide from everybody else. We judge somebody at some point. We see somebody from church doing something that we believe is not biblically appropriate. And then we put it on Facebook. Maybe you've been one of those people. They don't have to put your name out there. You know who you are. You know that you're the one they're talking about. And yet they want to attack you about your lifestyle, but they don't want to deal with their own gluttony. Gluttony has nothing to do with size. You can be 98 pounds and 6 foot tall and devour more tacos at Taco Bell than they've ever seen happen. No restrictions, no limitations, no boundaries, no discipline in their life. And then they're upset because you don't respond to that. How do we deal with that in the day that we live? How do we deal with this assignment to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry? Now, I'm better than I used to be. How many of you would be willing to say you're better than you used to be in terms of responding rapidly? How many of you are lying? Just asking. Because we'll find out later this afternoon on Facebook whether you enjoyed this message or not, or whether you were offended. Now, I normally don't get offended unless you talk about my wife, my kids, my grandkids, my ministry. That pretty much includes everything, doesn't it? I'm really trying to do better. And then sometimes we feel like we have a right as believers, spirit-filled, Bible-thumping, devil-chasing believers, to respond to everything. And you do. But how you respond is the critical element and component in the equation in terms of influence or effectiveness. And so all of a sudden, we find ourselves escalating. I've watched people. My wife told me this years ago. I used to watch the news, and I become so enraged and irritated that I start talking to the TV. Is there anyone else that talks to the newscast people and just goes, lies, lies, it's all lies? Or you hear something else. And my wife finally said, honey, they can't hear you. And my response was, I know, but they need to. My question again is, isn't it amazing how passionate and emotional that we get about someone else's wrong, but we don't always get that emotional and passionate about our own sin? Because if that was the case, the altar would have been filled today. Because there's none righteous, no, not one, except for the blood of Jesus Christ. And so I think there is an avenue that God wants to help us in the midst of this culture that is so offended. And some people get angry, and in that righteousness, in that moment and their anger, there is a feeling of moral superiority. I had an individual tell me one time, they weren't going to church anywhere, and they made this statement to a friend, well, I can't find a church that's preaching the truth. Does that set off a red flag to you? Well, there's a feeling of moral superiority when we become angry and offended and bitter and unforgiving. And so we may sit back and look at people and go, they're just evil. They're just wicked. They're just idiots. In fact, they're evil idiots. How do you deal with your anger in a day when the parallels and the signs of unrighteousness are so very clear. I was in a meeting Monday night with a church council, and they were discussing the avenues, and these discussions are happening in many places in denominational churches all over the world, because the hierarchy of the church is making decisions to give money to lesbian and gay groups, to pro-abortion groups, and that's not the biblical foundation of the church. And so this discussion was ongoing, and one lady stood up and said, I cannot in good conscience follow a denomination because this is sin, and I want to stay as far away as I can from sin. And I raised my hand because I was the moderator. I said, I understand what you're saying, but your desire to stay away from sin is incomprehensible and not attainable. Because Paul said, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, I do. Oh, wretched man that I am. The whole issue of us struggling internally is there. And then if you live in this world, you face it every day. We hear people's foul language. My problem is I'm hearing it more in the church than what I'm comfortable with. So we see all of these things happening. And then people walk into the church, and we have a knack and an ability to make other people believe that we're in pretty good shape when we're really not. Or we may be offended at some things, but how do we effectively handle our anger? Now, don't go back to the Gospels and say, well, Jesus made a whip and drove them all out of the church, and so I'm going to do what he did next Sunday morning. Well, our security will be all over you, sir. Just want you to know that. That's not how you handle things. When they came and called Jesus the illegitimate bastard son of Mary, Jesus did not say, I'm not going back to church, I'm bailing out of my life group, God is not fair. He had a purpose and he had a mission and he was anointed to make a difference. So how do we deal with all of these things that are surfacing in our society? When you're easily angered, and I'm not going to ask you to lift your hand, but there are moments where we see wrongs happening and things being taught in the kingdom that just are anti-biblical and lifestyles that people are living. I saw on my Facebook feed the other day, and I'm not making a judgment because we have argued over COVID, we've argued over the vaccine, and it's not moved the church forward. If you had COVID, I'm praying that there'd be no side effects. If you got the vaccine, I'm praying against any side effects. If you didn't get it, I'm praying for you. If you wore a mask, I'm praying that God would strengthen you. If you didn't, I'm praying for you. We cannot allow that kind of divisiveness. I know a church an hour and a half from here that decided they were going to put all the people that were vaccinated over here and they were going to put all the unvaccinated people over here. You are allowing the division of the enemy to create an offense, and you're helping that offense along. Where is it where we begin to listen to what people have to say and say, listen, I'm for you. I may not agree with you, but I'm for you. How do we handle the internal anger? Does your anger draw people to Jesus? Does your anger point people to the joy of the Lord? Does your anger create a relationship with Jesus? Are you more loving? Let me take you back to James chapter 1, and let's read verse 19 and 20. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Have you ever had a conversation with somebody and before they finished, you were already mad, but you didn't hear everything they had to say? How has your anger improved your marriage? How has your anger improved your relationships? Are you offended already? Look at verse 20. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. And we will cover that whole scripture where it says, be angry and sin not, let not the sun go down on your wrath. But let's not look for a way out yet. Let's come face to face and go, what is it that creates anger in me that causes me not to be loving, not to be more like Jesus, not to produce what I need to produce? Because your human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. But my anger is righteous. Have you ever had anybody tell you that? But my anger is righteous. Then let's take that same anger and judge ourselves and deal with the issues in our life that we have a tendency to sweep under the carpet. My question is, do you want to make a point or do you want to make a difference? Jesus didn't come to make a point. He came to make a difference. Have you ever been offended at God? I've been mad at God. I've said a number of things to him that I pulled out of the warehouse of my vocabulary from years ago and waited for lightning to strike and be sent to hell immediately. And it didn't happen. God can handle your stuff, but take it to him and let him diffuse it before you explode on somebody else. My concern is that the church has been very, very popular and very invested at telling the world what we don't believe. But we sometimes come short of embracing what we do believe. And so our posture has been a posture of, you know what, you shouldn't be doing that. You want to go to hell? You shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't be doing that. I got in trouble because I went to a tavern at a friend of somebody who attended our church and somebody saw my car there. So they automatically got offended. Not asking any questions, not asking what I was doing there, just offended that my 1972 orange Volkswagen was in close proximity of a Budweiser sign. And I think that we've got to be careful that we don't isolate ourselves, but we are insulated. We're not isolated. Look at Matthew chapter 22 and verse 37. Somewhere we must say, God, I don't want to allow my anger and my flesh to get involved in this. Help me, Holy Spirit, to be anointed to communicate what I need to and listen to what's going on in people's lives. I've not met a person yet that's in sin or addicted to something that has not had some trauma or tragedy or struggle in their life. And you and I have the ability to help them dissolve that through the power of the Word of God. But sometimes we make a judgment. I said to this church council, you say you want to be away from sin. What are you going to do if a drunk comes in on Sunday morning and you smell it on his breath? Are you going to leave the church over somebody that's not saved? We used to have a gentleman years ago over in Faith Chapel. He'd bring his cooler and leave it in the bushes. While we're greeting one another, he'd go out and get another Bud Light. Weren't you upset? No. He needed something to give him the courage. He was not saved. He was lost. Sinners do sinful things. And saved people sometimes do things that amaze me. Sometimes I do things that amaze me. Verse 37, Matthew 22. Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment in verse 38. Lord, I'm doing my best to try to do that. Well, let's read verse 39. Here's where the challenge comes. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. How are we doing, church? Are we loving our neighbor? Or are we offended at our neighbor because their dog uses our yard? Their cats are loose under our house. Whatever it is, it's amazing what people get offended by and upset about. And in the view of eternity, how are we navigating as a church? Are we still offended because people are not living righteously? Because bless God, I got my life straightened up in 2 weeks. Most of us are still working on it. Now that might offend you, but I'm just being honest. We are all a work in progress, and I think we have some keys, and I'll share them in just a moment, because Jesus didn't call you to be right. He called you to be loving. More important in my discussion with you, it's not as important for me to be right as it is for me to be right with you. Because if I lose my ability to have a relationship with you, then I've lost the ability to see God do something incredible in your life. I had a gentleman in my office years ago, and Sean Noel reminded me of who it was. He really didn't have any eternal philosophy. He just figured when you die, you cease to exist. I said, you don't believe we're gonna float around like little cherubs through the ethereal atmosphere somewhere in eternity? No. So I kept questioning him about what he believed, and he couldn't give me an answer. So when he couldn't give me an answer and I didn't rebuke him or get angry at him, he was open to listen to what I had to say. That young man got saved. We baptized him. He was the son of David Koresh from Waco, Texas. Do you remember? He's now in Michigan. As far as we know, he's doing well. And so I could have gotten upset with him and went, are you serious? Are you that much of a moron to believe that when you take your final breath, you just cease to exist? I didn't know he was the son of a Waco wacko. And the atmosphere that he was raised in, if the truth was known, all of us have had some challenges in our growing up, and maybe we have some challenges today, but there is something about the human nature that wants to feel like they have arrived at a place where they can finally say, I made it. I will meet you inside the pearly gates when Jesus comes, and we will all together lift our voice and say, we made it. Until then, we need to walk in the love of God, make a difference in people's lives, and not be so quickly offended at what's happening around us. Because Jesus didn't call us just to be right. I would like to say that I have a right to be angry, to fight injustices, but anger never wins a cause. And I know it's a challenge, and I know it's hard. And the whole pro-choice, pro-life is raising its head in opposition to one another. And it's now to the point where we hate people because of what they've done, and we have stopped loving them and trying to reach for them. I shared with you months ago that years ago, my brother-in-law and I, we sat on a bus for 18 hours and went to a pro-life march in January in Washington, D.C. And it was 70 degrees the day before. We marched through 7 inches of snow. We backed up traffic in Washington, D.C. How many of you know they were not happy about that? And many times we got half of a Hawaiian peace sign. But let me just say this, in all the love that I can muster up, I'm not against marching for what you believe is a righteous cause, but I haven't seen it change anything. Until the local church, until people begin to mentor young women and young men and help them understand the consequences of their actions, and that if they get pregnant, there is an avenue of hope, and you don't have to get an abortion. And if you've had an abortion, let me just tell you what Jesus thinks. He'll take care of your baby till you get there. Amen. We have to change the philosophy of the church, because we've looked down on people whose sin was so monstrous that how could you do this? And we have forgotten about the fact that Jesus said, if you're angry with your brother at a cause, without a cause, you're in danger of the judgment. And so we constantly are examining our heart and saying, God, how do we do this? I learned something this week, that MMA fighters do not allow their temper to get out of control, because when they get out of control and they get angry, they make grave mistakes. Have you ever said anything out of anger and you went, I wish I could get that back? So the element and that moment's gonna happen, but how can we limit those moments so we don't get overwhelmed? As disciples of Jesus Christ, how do we fight the battles of sin, iniquity, injustice, and ignorance without being angry? I think there's a couple of things that we can do. Number one, lower your expectations of others. People are people, no more, no less. Now you gotta hear my heart today. If for some reason between now and the time Jesus comes, I disappoint you, and some of you, I've probably already done that. If I disappoint you or do something that is out of character for me, don't bail out on God. Give up going, I'm not going back to church. God is a liar. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. In other words, if I fall, you go on. The closer I get to eternity, the more I'm guarding my heart. Because I look at young people today in our schools, people that are just getting married, etc., and it's like people are losing their common sense. And if they would just listen to me, how many of you are in agreement with me? If they would just listen to me, the world would be a better place to live. But it doesn't work that way. We have to be an example of the believers in faith, hope, and charity, and love in every way. I have to lower my expectations of others. Well, I can't believe he or she. I am shocked that they would. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3. Paul's writing to this young pastor, and the day that he's living in is just as complicated as the day that we're living in. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure more than God. Is that an adequate description of the day that we're living in? Even though it was written almost 1800 years ago? So in the midst of all of that, why is it that we are shocked that sinful people do sinful things? Why are we shocked that believers sometimes trip and fall and have struggles? Is it possible that we have created an atmosphere and an expectation of church that people don't want to come because they cannot meet the level of expectation? You don't know what I've done. I can't meet the expectation of people that go to church. Let me just be real blunt today. We are all broken people that need the power and the anointing and the blood and the name of Jesus Christ appropriated to our life. And we're on this journey. And you may have problems, but I can give you a list of 10 names in this house that are connected with this church that have had the same difficulty. But you don't understand. I had an abortion. I've been drunk every night. I did drugs. My veins are full of something right now. It's all right. We love you. And we know that God has the ability to transform your life. And the Word of God will transform you. And Jesus will never fail you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Because Jesus is the only one that is perfect. He will never let you down. I'm sorry, I've had good friends in ministry that said they would be there and didn't show up when I needed them. But I'm not gonna write them off because I wanna be confident in my relationship with him. And I wanna make sure that I don't return the judgment to them that's being placed upon me. Isn't it amazing how people will judge you without all of the information? They'll make decisions about whether they like you or not, and they won't even have a conversation with you. And they'll walk around in their righteous anger and validate their life. And God says, you're far from me. Because that has become as much sin as if you had done what they did. Oh, I didn't get any response there, so I'm gonna let you ruminate on that just for a moment. You're being upset and having righteous anger at what somebody else did that was not right is just as bad as what they did. I need to say it again. If we can't look through what they did and say, God, they're an individual, they're a human being, they're your creation, that is struggling, having problems, and I don't want to be the one that judges their sin. Somehow I need to develop a relationship with them so that somehow we can find a pathway for them to get a hold of Jesus Christ. And they're everywhere. Deborah and I live next door to a gentleman in Effingham, and his son was an alcoholic. His wife had left him with all of the kids. They had a six-month-old baby. And so I was just trying to reach him. I went to his home, and I was met by a large dog that put his hands on the top of my car. I knew at that moment with the discernment of the Holy Ghost that I probably should not get out. But after a few weeks, just having a conversation with him and not judging him, you got to hear me. We had an evangelist at church. Those were in the days when people would come more than on a Sunday morning and come to a special meeting. But this guy was from England. And this friend of mine was sitting with me. He would nudge me. He said, "When's the altar call?" He said, "I need to go and pray." I said, "It'll be okay." And he was scratching himself. He had hives. His nerves were frayed because he didn't have an antidote. He was trying to make it working a job and taking care of all these kids. So when the altar call was giving, he bolted out of the pew. He was standing there shaking under the power of God. And when that man found forgiveness without judgment, are y'all not hearing me? You could almost smell the alcohol on his breath, but he was intelligent enough to know he needed God. I've seen alcoholics sobered in 1 second in the presence of God. All of a sudden, the power of God came upon him. We thought something else had happened. He just found forgiveness. He turned to me and said, "Would you go home with me tonight?" I said, "No, I already have somewhere to go home with." He said, no, you don't understand. I need you to go help me get rid of something." We went home and emptied everything in his shelves that was creating his problem. He came to church for a while, but here's what happened. The church was so judgmental of him, he didn't come back. They got offended because he didn't straighten his life up quick enough. And that grieves me. Did their anger help resolve anything? Not at all. In John chapter 4, Jesus came across a woman at the well who had been married 5 times, and the man that she was living with was not her husband. And he ministered to her and had a dialogue with her. And when the disciples came back from getting him something to eat, they couldn't believe he was at the well speaking to a woman, because in their culture, that was not right. But when she found forgiveness and recognized that he was the Messiah and a true prophet, she dropped her water pot and went into the city and began to tell all the men who he was and what great things had happened to her. Peter was a little braggadocious, was he not? Yeah. Peter came up to Jesus and said, "Listen, I'm your man. I'm on your team. I'm in. I'm not out. Whatever happens, I'm for you. I'm with you. I'll never forsake you." But before the morning would dawn, he would deny the Lord 3 times. He would almost have decapitated the priest, and he only caught his ear. But Peter went and repented and had an incredible transformation. So how do we navigate this anger at what's happening in the world? Are you aware? Can I just feel your pulse a minute? Are you aware of the conflict and the offenses that are happening in our world? Watch television one day. Just watch it. People are upset about everything. And we've walked back into our sealed houses, and relationships have been isolated, and COVID prepared us for that. COVID put this mandate on us where we can make it and we don't have to have anybody else around us. Unless you're a believer and there's something that yearns and longs within your heart to connect with somebody and to see them get right with God. And where did that go? What happened to that in the church? Why has the church been more offended? There's a church in our nation that just despises military, I guess, and they show up at the cemetery and they make fun of these things. I had a man stand in my pulpit years ago, and he called gays and lesbians some name, and I said, "You will never do that again, Because if you want to call them out, let's call your sin out. It's easy to call out the drunkard, the alcoholic, the drug addict, the prostitute, but what about the gossip, the pride, the envy, the jealousy? I don't hear anybody preaching about that and getting righteously angry about that. And that's caused more division in church than any alcoholic or drug addict or pimp has caused. So how do we navigate all of this? Number one, lower your expectations of others. And number two, raise your gratitude for God's grace. For if it wasn't for the grace of God, it could be me. Let me take you to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Then I want to share one more story with you. God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done. So none of us can boast about it. Let me take you back to a story in John chapter 8 for just a moment. Can anyone within the sound of my voice lift your hand and say, I've never lied, I've never lusted, never stolen anything, I've never cheated, I've never done anything wrong? Because if you can, then you're very abnormal. But every one of us have our lives marked with something that characterized our past. There is a woman in John chapter 8 that was brought and thrown at the feet of Jesus. It was a plot by the religious Sanhedrin to catch Jesus in a trap. Finally, we can catch this man that has proclaimed that his father is God. She is in bed with this prominent man. And maybe he's a part of the plot. Maybe he's a part of the plan. But they break into the house unbeknownst to her. And they grab her as she tries to wrap herself in a sheet. And the man that she's having sex with, he's already gone. They don't drag him before Jesus, but they drag her. They cascade through the hallway and through the doorways, and all of a sudden her head becomes the object of that which strikes against the threshold. They're dragging her to the center of the community. They throw her at the feet of a man that she's only heard about and never met. She knows what the penalty is. She knows that the penalty for her sin is death, and they will stone her. And the religious people have gathered with their stone. Can I challenge you today that maybe sometimes we walk around with our stone in our pocket, never intending to use it, but just in case I do, I will defend the gospel with my anger. And yet that's never how Jesus addressed it. The religious people had gathered around. This woman by now has covered her face. She sees sandals and a man standing in front of her, but she dare not lift her face. She knows that she's guilty. She knows that she is worthy of the penalty that they're about to ensue upon her. Her tears are creating little pools and puddles at the feet of Jesus while the swirling dust of the Sanhedrin, as they stomp back and forth in indignation, begin to cover her. She begins to dream about the things that she could be but has never been. She really thought that she could overcome this by herself. But now she's in that place that she has dreaded for years, never thinking that she would get caught. And there she is in the middle of the square, and they're chanting, stone her. Jesus bends over and he writes in the dust. I wonder if he was writing the names of those men that were standing in front of him that had patronized the woman who now is prostrate on the ground. The book of Numbers, there was a test. They would take the dust and the dirt in front of the temple, they would mix it with water out of the temple. And if somebody drank this and their belly began to swell, they would know that they were guilty. But he doesn't do that. I wonder if he cancels the law. He just won the Holy One. And he looks up at the crowd and says, "You that are without sin, cast the first stone." The Bible says from the oldest to the youngest, they dropped their stones and they walked away. I don't believe she's even lifted her head. I believe she may still sense the ground shuddering from the weight of the Sanhedrin and the religious people as they begin to make their way of escape because they've been faced with truth that was not angry. Jesus could have looked at each one of them and said, "You right there in the back behind the older gentleman with the brownish garment and the staff, you were at her house 2 weeks ago on a Saturday night." He had the capacity to do that. He could have adamantly attacked their sin and said, "What are you thinking about?" But he came with grace and mercy and the love of God that is hard to embrace and said, "Those of you that are without sin, let him cast the first stone." He's not done yet because he looks at this young lady and says, "Listen, where are your accusers?" Jesus is so cool. She lifts up her head. Maybe she wipes the tears away from her face because she knows that she deserves death, and Jesus is giving her an opportunity at life. She looks around and says, "I don't know where my accusers have gone." He said, "Neither do I accuse you. Go and sin no more." Wow. Lower your expectation of others and raise the level of gratitude for the grace and the mercy of God. It will change your life. And sometimes we get aggravated. I understand that. We see people doing things that are horrible, and I don't want to diminish your pain. Please hear my heart. I don't want to diminish the pain that people have walked through and struggled with. But you don't know what they said. You don't know what they did. You don't know how they lied about me. You don't know how they rejoiced over my pain. I'm not diminishing that, but I do know this, that Jesus has the ability to heal your heart, that he has the ability to appropriate the grace of God. This world is becoming very challenging to live in, especially when you hear things that you know are absolutely not true and people judge you about things they have no authority to judge you about and haven't even had a conversation with you. Is it possible that we could release the grace of God, that it's not about gaining a point, it's about making a difference? I don't know about you. I really do want to be more like him. Song we used to sing years ago, "I have a long way to go to be like the Lord. Have a long way to go to be like the Lord." And I've been walking this for 47 years. Have a long way to go. The more I walk with him, the more I know that I need more of him. And we all have enough things that we could be judged over. Thank God for the blood. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. That immediately, without a board meeting, without a committee meeting, without pulling out a file on your life, Jesus forgives because he measures your heart. I don't know where you are with Jesus today. I don't know where you are in your relationship with God. But I think that the church is being positioned right now for one of the most cataclysmic, incredible harvests of souls that could ever be reached if the church can get over their offenses. A couple of years ago, they had a big tent revival in Arthur. They invited me to the leadership meeting to speak to them for 5 minutes. I said, if this meeting is a success, number one, it will not be because there's a lack of people that are sinners. But number two, if it is a failure, it will be because of our religious attitude making judgments about those that come, because church is not about a group of perfect people that come gloating over their perfections. It's about our imperfections, about our flaws. And sometimes we feel like the spotlight is upon us because we know what's happened in our life. But His mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. His victory on Calvary conquered death, hell, and the grave. There is no sin that is greater than another. It could be greater in consequences. Pastor, are you telling me that a murderer could go to heaven if he repents of his sin? Are you telling me that a child abuser could go to heaven if he repents of his sin? When did we become the jury and the judge as to what sin is greater than another, and who should go to heaven and who should not, and who should be a part of our church and who should not? Paul wrote and made a list of sin, and he said, so were some of you. I'll lift my hand because my name is in that category. But you are sanctified, you are set apart, you are consecrated, you are anointed, you are forgiven, you are righteous, you are just, you are holy, you stand in right relationship with God because Jesus took your sin on Calvary's cross, and now the arms of the church are open to the discarded, those that have been damaged, those that have had trauma, those that need the love of God. That's why we're here. Would you stand with me today? Could I challenge you to take this and just ruminate? My disclaimer is we have a few more weeks of this. I really didn't even want to say that because I hope the crowd does not diminish. Father, I thank you today for your great goodness and grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you that you have all power in heaven and earth. Thank you that there's nothing too difficult for you. But we declare what is written down. All things are possible to him that believes. God, I would ask you right now, as the church, we stand in need of your grace, of your power, of your ability. God, I ask you to forgive us of our judgment that seeps out in moments where we're aggravated and overwhelmed. I'm asking you to forgive us of our anger towards those that are in sin and the obscure, unrighteous, hideous things they do. But Lord, you died for them. Your blood will cover their sin if they will acknowledge it. I'm asking God that we would become everything that you desire, that sinners would come, because Lord, you went and sat down with sinners and publicans at the scoffing and at the rage of the religious people. And so God, I'm asking that you would open our hearts, forgive us of our transgressions, forgive us of qualifying sin. God, let us have the same righteous anger towards our own sin before we release that on someone else through whatever avenue. God, forgive the church for being on Facebook to such a degree that we have diminished and set ourselves apart so that now sinners are sure that they can even approach us. God, I ask you to help us today. Lord, so many of us that have gathered here today, if not all of us, have been the victims of people that have raised their voices on Facebook or verbally or through a letter or a phone call or a voicemail that have been angry. But God, we release them and we forgive them. We ask that the power of your grace and mercy would flow through us. And for those that have attacked us, God, we just ask that the power of the Holy Spirit would bring the conviction that only you can bring at the elements of their heart that would turn them to you. We thank you for it today. If you're watching online or you're within the sound of my voice, never given your life to Jesus Christ, can I tell you that he loves you? And if you've not been told today that you're loved, we want you to know that we love you, we care about you, that we're concerned about you. And if you're ready to pray this prayer wherever you might be or in this sanctuary, we want you to pray this with us this morning. All over this building, we'll pray with you. God's gonna do something incredible in your life. If you're ready to pray it, right now we're gonna pray. All over this building, pray it with me. Lord Jesus, I come to you today. I know I'm a sinner that needs a Savior. Forgive me of all my sin. Cover me with the blood that you shed on Calvary's cross. Fill me with your Spirit. I will do my best to follow you all the days of my life. Help me in this journey. Walk with me. I need your mercy. I need your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer today, let us know. We want to put something in your hands. We want to connect with you. We love you today. Let me just say to the church, I love you today. I thank God for you. But I want us to be everything that we can. I don't want us to get caught in the trap of a downward spiral that is a sinkhole that we can't get out of, because I believe that God is about to do something incredible through you and through us and fill this house and reach the lost and heal the brokenhearted and deliver the captive and mend those that are bruised in Jesus' name. We thank God for you today. We love you. We call you blessed.